The seminar you are about to enjoy is intense. CPU intense. Please ensure all web browsers, windows, and media-heavy programs are closed before participating. You may experience video and audio loss if running other programs. Thanks. AEOP membership is pleased to present this special edition of Person to Person. Tonight, join host Melissa Jones and her special guest, Dr. Aprille Ericsson, aerospace engineer for NASA Goddard Space Flight Center, as they take us to Mars and beyond.
All right. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to today's episode of Person to Person. This is the AEOP webinar series that aims to provide you with all the information, inspiration, and motivation you need to pursue a career in STEM. So, as you've already heard, today will be a very special episode featuring Dr. Aprille Ericsson. She is an aerospace engineer and instrument manager at NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center. Dr. Ericsson has already had an incredibly impactful career, and through her work, she has helped us gain a better understanding of the Earth and space. She's a truly amazing person, and I can't explain everything that she's done. So to help get into this, we're going to start off with a video introduction before meeting her in person. All right, so let's go ahead and start with that video.
I like building things, making things, fixing things. I'm big on thinking it and you will achieve it. We have a funny little clip. I call it my theme video. You know, every good hero needs a theme song, right? Seeing all of the different instruments and missions that I've been a part of to solve huge problems is never something that I started out to do. Here at NASA Goddard Space Flight Center, I start off doing attitude control systems. We don't say spacecraft having a bad day, but really position and location in space. So often people will call me a rocket scientist because I built and designed systems to control our spacecraft. And then moved into instrument management. I'm really the taskmaster in helping people meet the criteria that a scientist needs to create the cool stuff that you see around us. I was born in Brooklyn, New York. I grew up in Bed-Stuy. As we say, Bed-Stuy, do or die. I liked math from the very beginning. I played team sports. I still continue to do softball. My comic book favorite is the Cape Crusader. They used their brain and I could too. I moved to Cambridge, Massachusetts for high school. I applied to MIT and got in. But when I graduated from MIT, it was the year of the first shuttle disaster. And that was really hard. And jobs really weren't available at NASA. I went back to school. When I graduated from Howard University, I was the first African-American female to get a PhD in mechanical engineering. At NASA Goddard Space Flight Center, we have four science disciplines: helio, earth science, astrophysics, and planetary science. I've worked all different phases of the mission. One of my favorite projects is a lunar reconnaissance orbiter, because when I was in first grade, we got to see men go to the moon. It's a satellite that is basically using a laser, what we call a laser altimeter, to measure distances very accurately. You point the laser altimeter down to the surface and then bounce very quickly back up into your detectors and measuring that time and the distances. We're able to create three-dimensional maps of the moon, so you can see the very small craters down to 3 centimeters in resolution. That is very impactful when you begin to think about traveling in space. You need to know where you're going and where you're going to land. The James Webb Space Telescope is our next huge telescope, and we're hoping that it will actually take that same type of science and data that we've been collecting for Hubble and take it to the next level. It's 28 years in the making. So when they started the concept, the technology did not even exist. When we're looking at things in space, but we're looking way back in time, we're just finally getting the light. Different frequencies of light give us different clues. Infrared happens to be one of those spectral bands of light. With the James Webb Space Telescope, would give us some insight as to how quickly Milky Way is expanding, or even how long ago the universe was born. So for myself, this new position that I am, it's really being strategic about what NASA should be doing for the future. We may use sensors that look down at the Earth right now, but they may serve a purpose for us in the Martian environment or moon environment. As we try to figure out how to live on this big blue marble, we're going to succeed by working together. Diverse ideas spark innovation. They collide and create great solutions.
Wow, that is such a cool video, but even cooler, we have the person herself. Thank you so much, Dr. Ericsson, for being with us tonight.
Yes, thanks, Melissa. It's really good to see you again after a few years. And I must say that even when I watch that video, I'm usually really inspired, because the things that we do at NASA are always inspirational and they're pretty cool. So. I think that I was very fortunate for the World Science Festival to create the video, and I had a lot of fun when they did its debut in New York at the World Science Festival.
Yeah, your work is definitely very cool and interesting, to say the least, I must say. yeah, even in that like short clip, I was already introduced to so many more things that I didn't even know NASA was working on. And so I guess to start off the night, so everyone has a little bit of an idea about what we're going to be talking about, our goal is really to help everyone know that they have the power to be a scientist by, you know, helping them see your experience, your upbringings, how you found your path, and some of the projects that you worked on. And so with that, I really want to get into the first part. So in STEM, it's so easy to have like a preconceived notion of what a scientist is, what a scientist should look like, who they should be. I know, especially like from my experience, whenever I have like the image of a scientist in mind, it's someone from a particular like demographic or social group, or they were able to go to the best private high schools and go to the best universities. They had things that primed them for their career. But you, on so many fronts, you were like the first African-American woman to receive a PhD in mechanical engineering from Howard. And that's amazing. So you've already begun to break this stereotype of who a scientist should be and what they would look like. I was wondering if you could tell me a little bit about your backstory and your childhood.
Okay, so as is mentioned, and you actually saw pictures of me from elementary school. I had a big old fro. I only wore glasses shortly, but I really liked the glasses at the time when you're a kid, you know, so it kind of makes me look a little geeky. And I laugh about that now because I've been called a chic geek by the Congressional Black Caucus, right?
Wow.
I started off actually in a local school for kindergarten, and then I was really a really bright kid. And so it was suggested that I enter into the busing program in New York. And so I was bused really to predominantly white school. And I just excelled. I was really very good in math and science. And fortunately, in first grade, a parent brought a TV in and we got to crowd around that little black and white TV and watch the men go to the moon. So it was, and I remember that first grade year that us kids, we were like, we figured out how old they were. We figured how old we would be by the year 2000. And I remember saying, those guys seem really old. Like, you know, to a six-year-old, they were really old. But we were thinking about, like, how we could maybe be astronauts and what, you know, what year would that be when we'd be their age. And so we were doing math already, right? But I guess I had no fear or trepidation that these were just a job right now at that time for white males. And I knew nothing about hidden figures at that point in my life. It was many years later when I met Katherine Johnson. I met her almost 25 years ago. And I was well into my career at the time, but she was such an inspiration and we were receiving an award at the same time that I thought I needed to ask her, how did she solve those orbital navigation equations to the moon? And I had this deep affinity with us going to the moon because of what I saw in first grade.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, she said, oh, honey, it was easy. It was just solving a puzzle backwards in time. I knew where the moon would be. And so I just figured out how to solve the puzzle backwards. And I thought, like, duh. Well, yeah, I guess it is easy that way.
Oh, man.
But as I reflect, when I got a little bit older and I ended up going to junior high school in New York as well, I was in a special, what they call special progress or SP class. Mm-hmm. And I was the only Black child in my class. So there were always some fronts that I was traditionally breaking boundaries, even as young as 12 years old. And I was in all the honor societies. I was always excelling. And then I got an opportunity. I could have gone to the technical schools in New York. I passed all the exams for Bronx School of Science, Brooklyn Tech, and Stuyvesant, and would have went to Stuyvesant. But I really liked Cambridge, Massachusetts, which were my grandparents. And so you mentioned private schools. I actually got a scholarship to go to a private school. My parents could not have afforded this school at that time. And I was able to, again, excel during that time. And a teacher watched me would take homework to the back of the class. I would do the homework and hand it in because I didn't want to do homework on the way home. On my long ride from the suburbs on the train, I would do my other homework. But I wanted to play basketball with my friends. And most of them lived right in the neighborhood, so they didn't have that extra time for commuting. And I knew I was going to get my homework done because that was a must. So that was really kind of the things that led me. And this one teacher said, after seeing me do the homework, I was teaching myself the math. She said, you should go to this program at MIT. And then I ended up doing that and then later getting into school at MIT.
Oh, wow. That's so interesting. So you were able to meet someone who at least had some sort of role in the guiding you and like what sort of path you should take in terms of like advancing your career prospects. And I guess that leads me to my next question. So you clearly had like a really strong foundation in education, you're good in school. Was there one pivotal event or experience? Maybe it was that program, but was there one thing that led you to want to pursue a career in aerospace engineering?
Yeah, so it was actually that program that I mentioned. It was, at the time, it was called MITES. Well, at the time, it's called MITES now, but it was called UNITE for that, like, 2 years that I was in it. MITES is this phenomenal program that actually really exposes students to engineering and some math and some other things. And I actually, in that program, there were two things that occurred. I actually was building a bridge. We have a bridge competition. My bridge looked really nice. I'll even say it looked sexy because it was a really nice bridge. And I was further along than a lot of people when they had a camera guy come in. And I didn't know at the time he was taking pictures of shots. And my bridge and myself, we ended up on the front newspaper page for the tech. The Tech Talk is actually a newspaper at MIT. And I thought, if they would put this little brown child on the front cover of the newspaper, maybe this might be a place for me.
Right.
And then the aerospace part came because they actually, as part of the program, they took us to an Air Force base. And so I watched planes do touch and goes. I went up into the control tower and I also got in a flight simulator and I scored 2 points, 3 points or so off of a pilot score. I remember when I got out, I felt really bad because I had like 103 and everybody else was getting 300s and 400s. And I was like, dang. Wow, I did really bad. I thought I was kind of bad because I played Galaxia at night and things like that. I thought I had the eye-hand coordination, but I remember putting down my landing gear. I kind of got a little dizzy, but I was able to keep my plane level. And then this guy strides in with his nice flight suit on, and he says, I'm the flight instructor for the base, and if you've gotten a score of 100 and below, then you score the pilot score. And I was like, oh, shoot. Like,
oh, wow.
It was only me and my other friend who would stay up playing Galaxia with me at night that scored those close scores. And so I was bitten. I was like, yeah, aerospace might be the thing for me.
That's so cool. Mm-hmm. I must say I did also enter bridge competitions. None of them worked out, which is why I'm not in any of these like technical fields of engineering. Oh man, but you brought up a really good point about, I guess, like seeing yourself on like the front of the magazine cover kind of, you know, opened up the area to you. You know, like, I guess for many African-American students or like students of color minorities, it's hard to imagine yourself at these places where there's not lots of representation. So I guess it's really hard for students who already have this like barrier to deal with difficulties in this context, you know? So do you ever encounter any difficulties that made you question your right to be in that area, or
yeah,
any hard classes and experiences? And like, how did you work through that and overcome that?
Yeah, that's a good question, Melissa. So first of all, I'll start off with saying that I often quote something out of the greatest salesman of the world, which is a book play. And it says the prizes of life are at the end of each journey, not in the beginning. And it's not necessary to know how many steps I need in order to reach my goal. And so at that time, I got really excited about engineering and science. But for some reason, even though I'd come in with this hot and heavy kid doing math and science, and then I ended up doing really, really well on the Massachusetts math competition, I left my high school without calculus. Like, who goes to MIT and doesn't have calculus? Like, I interview students now, and some of them are doing differential equations in high school. And so one thing, when I got this bug, suddenly everybody around me, teachers and stuff, okay, we need to get you physics and chemistry. Well, I had already taken biology and earth science. And then they said, okay, well, we're going to need to get you calculus. But there wasn't any way. I hadn't taken pre-calculus. So I took trigonometry, analytical geometry, and pre-calculus, physics and chemistry, all in the first half of my senior year. Yes, wow. I crammed it in because I saw something that I really wanted to do. And people were saying, okay, you need to do this. But there was no way to get the calculus before. And so when I got to MIT, I actually struggled with calculus. And fortunately, your first year, you're on pass and fail. So I was able to pass through that class, both of the classes for calculus, one and two. But it definitely was impeding my ability to do well on some of my exams. I understood the physics. I loved physics, chemistry, material science, you know, all of these classes. And then by the time I got to the beginning of my sophomore year, I took differential equations. And boy, you know, as they say, it's difficult. And I did not pass for the first time. I failed a class. Like, I'd never had anything lower than a B. Like, most, you know, all through high school, I was A's. And then to get to college and then to do, you're like suddenly at MIT and you're not the best student. And it was really hard. And I didn't fail that class once. I failed it twice. Because the second time I took the class, I took it with math majors. And I'm like, I'm an engineer trying to just solve these problems. And so it's really challenging, but I did create a good relationship with the teacher that taught it that second semester. He ended up winning a math award that was like the Nobel laureate. I mean, he was just a really phenomenal teacher. And he said something to me, both he and my then new advisor, Dr. Sheila Whitnall, they said, you just need to get this math under your belt. Like, my advisor had me in her classes in fluid dynamics. She's like, I've seen you in class. You're good. You just need to get this tool under your belt. And then I think you'll do fine. And so I took a semester off. I went to City College of New York and I got a 98 on the final. Like, I think I got it now.
Nice. Yeah.
And I ended up teaching those classes later as a professor at Bowie State. I taught math classes. So it was a big confidence booster. It really helped me to succeed doing, you know, graduate work later, all of the things that would, you need a good foundation for math. And I used to be really embarrassed by telling that story. So I never told anybody, but it, you know, cause it caused problems with my GPA, but then you could see my grades just go straight up. I ended up with a 5.0 my last year, you know, it's just awesome.
Wow.
And so that's why I said, you never know how many steps, you never know what kind of things are in your path, the boulders. But when you put your eye on the prize, you've got to go ahead and go for it. You've got, if something knocks you down, you got to get back up.
That's definitely so encouraging. I know that like imposter syndrome is such a really like prevalent thing in especially STEM fields, because you feel like everything is graded based off technicality. So you miss one number and you've got something wrong. You have a 50%, you know? And it's so easy to let that grade define like your capabilities in the future. But clearly, as we can see, that's not the case.
Let's talk a little bit about the imposter syndrome. So I have talked to many of my, I would say minority. And when I say minority, not to exclude Asian Americans, but really talking about more of our brown folk like Hispanics and African Americans, even American Indian, many of us deal with that imposter syndrome. But one of the things that I find, and I'm very fortunate, I have a very strong and supportive family. My mother taught me from very young that you can do anything you put your mind to. And we did learn as very young children, African-American history, African history, which is not, wasn't at that time very typical. I had cousins who were in Boston and they didn't know anything about some of the people that I knew about. And they have always been an inspiration for me. So I've sought and felt solace in knowing African contributions from like the Nile Valley. You know, there's a bird of Saqqara that was created by the Egyptians. And they believed that it wasn't a bird, but it was actually a flying model. And so when I find out these things and I'm going, wow, these people are extremely capable with, you know, sort of meager things around them. They didn't have trains, cranes, and buses, but yet they put up the pyramids.
Right.
Those are the things that are inspirational to me. And I realized, like, we are so capable of so many things. And we shouldn't allow others around us to sort of taint our confidence. We really need to believe in yourself. And sometimes that's hard, but if you want to succeed in life, you sometimes have to pick yourselves up by the bootstraps and just push on. And, you know, people often say too that, you know, anything that comes easy is usually not as rewarding, right? It's the hard right. stuff that you really feel the strength and the gusto. And so, you know, for colleagues at NASA to say, I feel like that imposter syndrome, it's really pretty deep what occurs in our society to make us feel that way. I actually kind of sort of felt that way with the fact that I went to a HBCU for my PhD, but yet I'd gone to MIT. So you could not negate that I could work in both realms and still be very successful.
Right.
And and I would say I just let other people's hangups be their hangups. It's not going to stop me.
That's definitely so encouraging. So I'll definitely keep that in mind, especially going into college, to make the motivation internal and not like dependent on external things like grades and other opinions. I just wanted to go ahead and say this now. So if any of you guys, viewers, have any questions about Dr. Ericsson and her journey and anything that we talk about, feel free to leave a question in the chat box and we will be addressing them both throughout the presentation and throughout the interview, and also we'll have like a dedicated time at the end.
So I noticed Japish said he lives near Goddard Space Flight Center, so you must live close to Greenbelt, Maryland. We could see that happen, of course, with COVID. I'm not working at my center right now, and they're not allowing any visitors either. We do have about 20 to 25% of our work staff working right now. So we can see in the future if that's a possibility. If you, it's not likely to be my work because I do more of strategic work now. We can talk about that in a little bit.
Awesome. So thank you, Japesh, for asking that question. And we're going to go into our next topic. But if you still have any questions on Dr. Ericsson's backstory, feel free to drop those in the chat. So we're going to talk about post-schooling. After you've gone through gone through MIT, got your PhD, you started your career at NASA. So could you tell me a little bit about your role there, just in a really general sense, and how you transitioned into various projects?
So I actually started working at NASA when I was still in graduate school. I actually started my first internship at the Langley Research Center, which is where Katherine Johnson worked. And I have a bunch of colleagues and friends there. And then I was supported partially with scholarships and funds from them and the Air Force. And then I, maybe just a few years after the master's degree, I was walking through the hall and they had a career day. And there was a representative from Greenbelt, Maryland, Goddard Space Flight Center. And I did not know anything about Goddard. And he said, you would be perfect for working there. Eventually, what occurred is he intrigued by interest of co-op, which is now what we call pathways. And then he also, I ended up thinking, gee, I don't have to move out the state. And so that's kind of what pushed me to really seeking what was going on at Greenbelt, Maryland. And I actually applied for a program, believe it or not, after the deadline, but they liked me so much. And I was such a rarity because I was this African-American woman working on a PhD. I'd gone to MIT, you know, just all those pieces that they actually interviewed me. And they called me after they'd already selected. I didn't even know this at first. I found this out years later because I had a great relationship with the office. And they went and found extra money for me to get in the door. So I often tell students, like, don't let anybody tell you no. And make sure you put your best foot forward with every interaction. They were such good sort of supporters and protectors of students and helping us to nurture our careers. So I actually, in my first presentation for the end of the summer, I won their competition. And in the middle of my presentation, the head of engineering was offering me a job.
Wow.
So I started co-oping and then and did their pathways and then entered their workforce. And so I love my job. And if you saw the video, I've had multiple careers. So I did attitude control systems, controlling spacecraft, motion and ability to motion. Actually, I started off in robotics, which is the one thing we were talking about. And it was because I did multi-body dynamics. And that was my research was controlling large space structures. I ended up there. Mm-hmm. But they could dissolve that group and they moved robotics to some of the other centers. And then I did attitude control systems. So I was used to controlling big things like the space station. And then I learned how to effectively do the smaller spacecraft that we do. Although there are some that are still fairly big, like the Hubble and the James Webb Space Telescope, but nothing quite as big as the International Space Station. And that was really the research applications. And then I slowly moved out of that. I did, I started to design and develop future missions. And then I went to headquarters. I went to headquarters first in Earth Science as a program exec, and then later in space science. And I was more of a business executive. So I wanted to learn in the program exec, I wanted to learn how we take requirements for science and flow them down to our engineers. How do we come up with those topics and themes? How do we really make those decisions on a larger policy level? And then also with the business exec, I wanted to see how the money flowed down and how did we do that whole cycle with Congress and the Office of Management and Budget. So I really wanted to see the big picture. When I came back to Goddard and I came back in between, I started the instrument management from $15 million instruments to my last one, which we'll talk a little bit about, ISAT, which is a $500 million instrument on a $1 billion project. James Webb, I had the near spectre detector, which is an infrared spectrometer. And so I was really managing very large teams by the time I stopped doing the management. I moved into technology. I became the deputy to the chief technologist for engineering. I focused on what we call CubeSats. So CubeSats are a cube in the measurements of CubeSat is like the size of a coffee cup. Typically at our Goddard Center, we typically do like a 6U, which is the unit of CubeSats. Mm-hmm. And that's like the size of a boot box, about that size. It's a little bit big, or maybe a big sneaker box. And I also did looking at materials and structures, new technology for that, and then nanotechnology. And then I moved into being a program manager for our small business and innovative research programs. And so I worked with industry, small businesses to develop the technology that we need to fill the gaps for our programs. I also will sometimes work with other agencies like the DOD to with that program, because many of the other agencies that have research portfolios also have SBIR. And then as I began to shift, I tried to figure out what was I going to do next. And I actually started back into project management of missions. A very cool one. One of my favorite was StarX, and it's an astrophysics mission. We look at what I call sexy science, like black holes and those things, looking really at a new technology with these very thin grazing incident mirrors. One of the coolest principal investigators, great team. And they're actually getting ready to pre-propose, but they selected two missions and we were the third. We're like so close. And then I moved into the now new position, which is new business lead for the instrument systems and technology division. And I really helped to support our teams. I helped direct technology. I actually am now doing something for SBIR as well. I run the entire topic for sensors and detectors across our NASA centers. So I've got colleagues all over the country that are working to design and to say, this is what we need for technology from the businesses. Mm-hmm. And so I'm an acting chief technologist as well right now for my group. So love those jobs. And of course, on the side, I do teaching and have done teaching. And Now I'm teaching younger groups. So I'm not necessarily doing it in the as a professor in a university, but on a campus, I was doing NSBE Junior. So,
That's so cool. Yeah. You definitely had so many different positions, as you mentioned.
Yeah, and it's 25, well, it's actually 28 years at Goddard. Yeah.
How did you, how were projects determined? Like, how did you know what you're going to work on from year to year?
So the only thing that I knew in the beginning was when I was coming out of MIT, I talk about the shuttle disaster. I knew that I didn't necessarily want to do missile defense.
Okay.
And so that was one of the reasons why I chose to go back to school and do a PhD. Also, things were kind of different. Manned space flight was just in that period where they're trying to figure things out. So that was also the other reason. But I just wanted to focus on, you know, applications that were, I would say, more Earth-friendly. And I just really lucked up with Goddard because Goddard is all about science. And we do have communication satellites as well, but we really are about supporting the four sciences that I also mentioned in the mini. So I'll repeat them. Heliophysics, astrophysics, space science, and planetary science. Those are our main focus areas, but we do support the health exploration mission directorate as well. So sensors and detectors and communication like laser comm and things like that. We are also helping to integrate and support those missions. And then one other aspect is with heliophysics with space weather. Space weather, of course, is big for even our partners like the Air Force and the Army. But there is this definitely, you know, a concern that you're sending humans in space. And so you need to really understand the weather that's occurring in that environment.
Right. That's so cool and definitely makes a lot of sense. We have a lot of questions coming in about your projects. So why don't we talk about some of your projects first, and then we can maybe see which one was your favorite.
Okay.
So the first one I want to ask about is the Mars GIM project. Could you tell me a little bit about what that was and like some of the associated experiments?
Uh-huh. So Mars GIM was really pretty cool because it was actually a concept. It was never selected. It was because it was considered very risky, but it's actually getting closer and closer to being selected now because we're going, you know, different ways of looking at Mars. This mission would have actually been the first to bring back dust particles and gas samples from the Martian environment. There was another mission very similar to it called Stardust, which flew behind an asteroid and they were able to collect some of the particles from it. Unfortunately, with Stardust, when it came in, it's actually there was an engineering build mistake where they inverted the accelerometers that would measure how quickly you were coming in as you approached into Earth. And so it actually was, one of them was in reverse and it crashed into the desert. So some of the part of the system was contaminated. And I think that's actually what made people think that this mission would be risky. But skim would actually, if this was Mars, it would actually just kind of skim very low to the atmosphere, collect, and it's a very dusty atmosphere. So it would collect particles into something we called aerogel. There were trays inserted in the side of this cone, like looks almost like the top of a launch vehicle, ballistic vehicle, just a cone shape. And in the side were these grooves with the aerogel trays. Once the particles were embedded in this, it's like captured smoke. It's so thin and very lightweight. The particles would then be attracted. The whole tray was retracted into the interior. Actually, before I say that, before it was retracted, it would be baked out a position because we were afraid of bringing harmful biological samples back that could contaminate our university. So that was the other risky part, because how can we believe? We don't know what other entities, what their tolerance would be. So even if we baked it out at some extreme temperature, who knows? They might be able to survive.
Right.
So that was the other piece. They're still trying to figure out planetary protection. And then it would retract, and they had these trails that kind of led it down into an interior capsule. And when that would come back to Earth, it would shoot that out and then it would drop to Earth. So very cool. It had a nozzle also in the top that collected the dust, and the particles would be in the trays. Very
That's
nice.
That's so cool.
Yeah, it's a very cool mission.
And it sounds like you guys would have had to develop a lot of new technologies in order for that to work, right?
Yeah, the other thing is that people also get really nervous when you have a lot of moving parts. And so in this case, we had a retracting tray with sort of like a trail down into this system, this capsule at the bottom of the cone. You also have a open inlet at the top. So you have to retract that open inlet to open it up and then close it. So there, you know, whenever you have mechanisms, people are always a little nervous because they can fail. And, but yeah, I really liked the team. And it was my first time actually having an opportunity to work with JPL, Jet Propulsion Laboratory. And, you know, that's one of the areas that they excel at is with Mars missions.
That's so cool. Do you think the project will be, I guess, continued in future years or implemented?
I think that we are looking at different concepts now. Because of the rovers and the capabilities that we have with laboratories in situ, so meaning on the ground, we are kind of taking the labs with us versus bringing the particles. But we hope eventually there are some concepts that I've seen where you would have a lander kind of similar to the Apollo days. You know, you have the lander and then it launches off the surface. So there are some designs for those type of missions now. And so that would actually get a chance to dig deeper into the surface. You know, we have drilling machine and robotic arms that can kind of do that. I have a friend of mine and who I went to school with, Dr. Eddie Tunstall, who actually did part of developed the arm that was able to drill and get core samples. And we are able to confirm that hematite, which shows potentially the presence of water, what they call Martian berries. Wow. Yeah, and went to school with me at Howard University. Awesome, doing all kinds of really cool type of stuff like that.
That's so interesting. Definitely a super cool project. Love to see the new approaches that you guys come up with in the future. Mm-hmm. So that's just one of many. I wanted to move on to your next project. Something we've all heard of, which is, you know, the new James Webb Space Telescope, which is replacing the Hubble Telescope, which apparently has taken over 1 million pictures in the course of its existence. And the James Webb Space Telescope is scheduled to launch in 2021, right?
Yes. Awesome. Yes.
So soon.
I'm crossing my fingers. Yeah, so they actually finished all integration. I just saw some pictures of it fully folded up. So, you know, we fold up a lot of our devices, especially when they're huge, like the James Webb Space Telescope. And by that's not my second mission. I had a bunch of them as an attitude control systems analyst, from things that monitor tropical rainfall to X-ray timing explorer, which was looking at X-ray particles. They looked at neutron and binary star systems. I also designed many different concepts. So I've had I had multiple missions before even becoming an instrument manager. And then I had a bunch of missions as well, up until the one working on the James Space Telescope. And then a few after that too. So James Webb though is actually one of the few that I've worked on and has not launched yet because it's really taken so long. And I mentioned that in the video at the time, it said 28 years. Well, now here it is, fast forward. So it's been 3 years, I think 2.5 years since that video was developed. So it's 30 plus years that we've been designing the technology. And when we started, the technology was not even developed. And it takes a while to develop the technology. And it's so large and it has so many moving parts as well. Yeah, so I suggest you go ahead and show the video.
Yeah, let's go ahead and roll up and we can maybe address some of those like questions after.
under construction is the premier telescope of the next decade. A next-generation space telescope designed to cause yet another giant leap forward in our understanding of the cosmos. It will carry some of the most advanced technologies ever placed on an orbiting observatory.
"18 articulated mirror segments, 2.75 times the diameter of Hubble's primary mirror. Microshutters, wavefront sensing and control subsystem, 12 by 18 meter, 5-layer captain-based sunshield."
The Webb Telescope. A revolutionary tool, able to study every phase in the history of our universe.
The Webb Telescope.
Very cool. Yeah. You mentioned, go ahead.
I was going to say, one of the things that is really inspirational about that, I have a colleague, Dr. John Mather, and he's a much older scientist, but I first got to work with him on the Wilkerson microwave anisotropic probe. It's called WMAP. And that was my last mission as an attitude control analyst. And I solved some really difficult problems with what we call solar wind to make sure that people felt comfortable about the way that we were laying out our solar panels, that they open up into almost like a top hat in a sense. They protect the instrument, but they also allow us to collect our solar field, sun's energy. And if they were slightly canted, they might cause it to spin with a way that would perturb its motion. And that scientist, Dr. Mather, was the PI on it. He had been on another mission called COBE, and he ended up winning the Nobel Prize for that, the research and the things that he's done. Well, now he's the PI, principal investigator, on James Webb. And so the chance to work with him again, and I've had the opportunity to introduce my daughter, and she, as a younger person, when, you know, this was like maybe 2 years ago, I think, or so, and she got up in an auditorium with like 200 people and asked her a question. He was like, "That's a really good question." Like, you know, so he is just such a nice gentleman, and he's willing to just share his knowledge. He's mentoring one of our younger, newer colleagues now, and I'm kind of helping too. So the chance that we get a chance to input into the next generation is really important to us. James Webb is really hard. I actually looked it up because I remember I told you how much it costs. It's $10 million right now. I mean, $10 billion. $10 billion. $10 billion. And I was working at the time on new technology for the infrared detectors. What's so important about the infrared detectors is that it picks up, you know, thermal imaging and sensing from a temperature perspective. And that becomes important when you're looking out into space and you see these dust particles. It sees through that, because that is really more of a visual impairment, and you can see past the dust particles into sort of really the condensed matter of a planet or something else, whatever's forming a galaxy. So you can kind of bypass some of that. And so that's very, very helpful. But the things like the solar panels, people see these big, beautiful array of the mirror, as I call them, light buckets, right? They've got a collecting area on one side. Usually they have a very small mirror here. And as the whatever particles or x-ray or whatever they're collecting hits that surface, it bounces into a smaller mirror. Well, to really be able to see farther, you need bigger and bigger collecting areas for that primary mirror. And so the cool thing about James Webb is it actually folds up, and it folds out with this honeycomb kind of looking shape, and they are covered with gold. That is actually real gold coating.
Wow.
Yes. And that actually helps it to reflect very well. The material that the mirror is made of is called beryllium. So it has very low thermal distortion. So it doesn't vibrate and shake a lot with the changes in sort of temperature that you experience in space. And why I know so much about it, because ISAT-2, which is one of the last missions that I worked on as a manager, we actually use the same beryllium procurement. We purchased them from the same small company. Northrop Grumman oversaw the mirror development, but this small company hand polishes these mirrors to perfection. And when I was on one of my site visits for my own mirror for ISAT-2, the James Webb Space Telescope mirrors were there and they were getting ready to ship them out. So I got to like go see them in the shop. And then later I saw them again later at our own facilities. So there's quite a bit of technology. There's something called micro shutters, these very small shutters that open and close, and just very challenging things that weren't in our detectors. They weren't developed at the time, but now they're brought to fruition, and it takes money to do that. Yeah,
definitely the gold-plated mirrors would explain the $10 billion budget for that project.
Actually, most of the money goes to humans for us to work, to design, to do it, more so than the hardware. That's part of it, but you also, the pedigree of parts are really important. So you may use very similar parts that you might find in your cell phone, but those parts are not what we call radiation hardened. So as you pass through that radiation environment in space, you have to make sure that it's not going to disrupt or cause things to short out or break out. So that's also the other part, that the parts are more expensive, although they may be very similar in capability, but they have to go through very rigorous testing. Yeah.
That makes sense, especially for the fact that, you know, you already know the project's going to take such a long time. I guess you have to also factor that in.
Yes. And that's hard as engineers, because we want it to be the best it could possibly be. But with James Webb, it's 30 years in the making. And so the things that they start off designing for and putting into the system, they're almost antiquated by the time you actually launch something that has these capabilities. But it'll be the first time we've proven them in space. So, you know, although you want something a little better, it is what it is. Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense. That's super cool. And you actually touched on one of your more recent, did you say it was your final project, the ISAT-2?
So ISAT-2 is the last mission that I actually managed. $500 million instrument. Yeah, like $500 million. I was the lead. I started off as a deputy, then I took over as acting. And then we eventually hired a manager. And I decided that I wasn't going to take the job forever or for the duration, because I had, my daughter was fairly young. Mm-hmm. And I was like, this is a big job. Like, I really need to also be able to focus on her too. And I could still do many of the other things, but being the lead, it really requires like full attention. The thing that somebody said was my favorite, I typed it in the chat, but my favorite was actually the instrument LOLA, which is the laser, it's a laser altimeter, very similar to what you saw in the video with the beams bouncing down and back, same type of technique. And it was able to create these three-dimensional maps on the moon. And it's just because my love for the moon as a child that it was one of my favorite. And it was a great team. And a lot of that team went with me to ISAT-2. So I got to work with them again.
That's so cool. And speaking of ISAT-2, we do have one final video that kind of explains a little bit about what that does. So
okay,
let's go ahead and check that out. And then maybe we can talk about it again a little bit after.
Okay.
From satellite data, we have a very good handle of how our Earth looks like. We can see oceans, we can see the sea ice, we can see our forest. What is much, much harder to measure is how high things are on a global scale, almost impossible.
ISAT-2 adds the third dimension, the elevation. Repeating measurements from ISAT-2 will allow us to measure changes in the ice sheets or in the ocean or in land.
ISAT-2 is designed to measure the changes that are going on in the cryosphere, in the polar regions.
All the change is at the edges. Those are the steeply sloping parts of the glacier that interact with the ocean, and that's where all the action is. That's where all the mass is being lost.
In order to estimate the mass changes, we need to know the height of things. The mission ISAT-2 carries a single instrument. It's called ATLAS, the Advanced Topographic Laser Altimeter System.
ATLAS sends out small pulses of laser light 10,000 times a second. And by measuring precisely how long it takes that light to go from the spacecraft down to the Earth and back up to the spacecraft, allows us to figure out what the height of the surface is beneath ISAT-2.
We need to measure the time of flight of a single photon or a single laser pulse with a precision of a billionth of a second.
NASA engineers had to come up with entirely new ways of measuring time very precisely.
A billionth of a second translates to an elevation change precision of just a few centimeters. Climate change is amplified in the polar regions. ISAT-2 is designed to measure those areas and will help us to understand what's going on with our planet.
So, ISAT-2, of course, is probably like my second favorite mission. And it's largely because I really believe in the impact that we have for science, the opportunity to collect the data that shows the impact of climate change, I think is just such an important global issue.
Right.
And I'm just always tickled that I had the opportunity to work with such a great group of people, and we were able to pull off, like, we are actually getting data way better than we even expected. Like, you can actually see the ice under the water, and
wow.
You know, that, like, whenever I ask my old teammates, hey, what's going on, what do we have lately, and they get all excited and they pull up the new plots, and I mean, it's just really cool. And those guys, they really love it. The scientists, they get a chance to go sometimes up to the poles, and of course they always come back telling us penguin stories or something like that, you know. but they are passionate about really helping to figure out what's going on our planet. And the evidence is in the data. Yeah.
Right. So you mentioned that, like, as the show was shown in the video, lots of the projects that you work on have impacts on, like, our world and just, like, our experience as, like, normal citizens on Earth. So I guess my question is, how have your, like, technologies developed at NASA impacted the life of ordinary citizens?
Oh, wow. That's a great question. Melissa, it is just, there are so many technology spinoffs that's one of the things that I actually help to lead. And even right now with COVID, we're actually, some of our technology, we're helping to develop a breathalyzer that could actually be able to detect the COVID virus.
Oh, wow.
And it's using nanotechnology. We just got some funding from the CDC. So we are actually trying to convert it so that it could be something that would be replicated. Typically, what we do is we don't create the stuff that can be manufactured and distributed to the common day citizen. We work with companies who will spin the technology off. They might put their little spin on it, but using that technology to create great things. It's been things like handheld X-rays that, you know, you might use on the football field, or with the Hubble Space Telescope, if you remember, the lenses were improperly grounded, and we were able to come up with an algorithm for how we scan in the future, how we scan the surfaces. We actually use that same algorithm and computer algorithm to scan your eyes. So if you're going to do LASIK surgery, they're able to use that now. We use star trackers. So star trackers take pictures up in the sky. They then look at comparing the dots that they see in the sky and finding the star charts to actually identify, okay, this is where we are, this is what we're seeing. Well, we use that same technique to help ocean biologists to track things like whale sharks, because the back of a whale shark has a unique pattern. It's like a fingerprint thing, where the unique pattern looked very much like a star pattern. And they use crowdsourcing. So if people happen to see them, take pictures, and then they have a catalog of these pictures, and then they are able to match it up through their catalog, like which whale, and maybe track it and see where it's gone. And so, yeah, there are lots of things like that.
So that's so cool. I didn't even know that some of these technologies were used in that way.
Excuse me.
Bless you. And it's also really interesting because you mentioned that even over the course of the development of the James Webb House telescope, that technologies were being developed over time, like in that short period. So you guys must make lots of contributions to.
Yeah, even things like if you use Pyrex, you know, if you use the ceramic, that type of ceramic, high temperature ceramic is something we do with the bottom of the shuttle tiles. It's the shuttle tiles, when they come in, you know, it gets heated up, and that's high temperatures that it experiences were able to be deterred from entering into the vehicle because of the ceramic tiles that were put in place. And I've actually seen demonstrations where somebody had one of the ceramic tiles, they take a torch and blow that torch directly onto the tile, and then take the torch away. And then you can take your hand and touch it within, you know, 30 seconds of doing that.
It's not hot.
Yeah, and it's not hot. It like absorbs the temperature. And so these technologies have applications elsewhere. And, you know, we love that part. When I review the things that we review for small businesses, the proposals, that's one of the aspects I look at. How will this spin off? Will there be other industries that could use it? Because we want to see it benefit other places in the world.
That's so cool. Thank you for explaining all of those other applications. Unfortunately, we were running out of time. So in the last couple of minutes, we're going to take some questions directly from you guys, the budding scientists. If you have anything you want to know about Dr. Ericsson, about her journey, about how you should find your journey, we'll do that now. So
I see Victor has a question. He says, what are the big challenges regarding settling and surviving on Mars in the long term? Well, one of the big things, the issue, first of all, is mapping. So we think we're going to have that down pat, similar to how we've been able to map out the moon. We'll be able to map it out in higher resolutions, but we have fairly good maps. The thing that for humans is a really important thing to think about is radiation. So how do you protect people in that environment? You know, your exposure, and don't have the Earth's atmosphere to protect you, particularly from UV, but there's other forms of radiation that the body would be bombarded with. And so that becomes one of the challenges with going to Mars and then living on the Martian surface. Of course, we have to replicate or develop oxygen. We have techniques that are being done to create like a plant. So they actually think they would send robotic type or manufacturing type plants that would land on the surface and begin to create the oxygen and the other things that we need to breathe, nitrogen. There would also be the aspect of the extreme temperatures. You will typically see more extreme temperatures without, again, the protection of the Earth's environment. A long duration space flight. You do not get the gravitational influence on your body actually helps us to keep up the skeletal structure as well as our muscles. And when you're in space, you don't have to use the same muscles, right? You just kind of glide around and float around. But also your bones are not experiencing the impact. And so when your bones experience impact, they actually are strengthened. And so we see it's similar to what women experience. Osteoporosis tends to be something that more women experience than men. But you begin to get what we call decalcification. And so the calcium leaks out the bone. So we've actually looked at studies associated with osteoporosis to figure out how to counteract that effect. So I hope that maybe that is just a smattering. If we are really to settle on Mars long term, things like transportation vehicles, Mars doesn't have the same type of atmosphere. So you can't fly planes. You might have to do something different with your helicopters. How do you get across the planet long distances? What kind of system? Would you do a monorail system? How do you create cement to build up those kind of structures? You know, all of those things really become critical. We have solved some problems like 3D manufacturing. You know, when we do 3D printing, this actually allows us the capability to do it in other environments. We could even design things here to solve problems as someone was traveling. If someone was hurt, maybe we'd send them a 3D printed. I like the Lost in Space. I used to watch Lost in Space when I was a kid, but there's a newer version. And that actually happens where the mother gets hurt and she needs a brace. So they 3D print the brace. And so some of those aspects we begin to solve so that we can do immediately solutions to, you know, everyday sort of life experiences.
That's so cool. Mm-hmm. I guess two questions that involve telescopes. Will the new telescope pictures come in color? And also, are there new planets and solar systems being discovered every day?
So I think that there are planets being discovered. I don't know about every day, but with the James Webb Space Telescope, that will be almost a daily occurrence because we'd just be seeing things so much further and so much clearer than we have in the past. And so even things like asteroids will be able to see so much clearer the features of these things than we can actually, you know, you can, a geologist can look at a surface and determine by the structure whether there was water presence. And so when you'd be able to see the granularity and higher resolution pictures, you'll be able to determine some of the things about the evolution of the, not just the solar system, but the universe. And so think even larger than solar system. Solar system just mean you're orbiting around some star system. And so there are many, 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 you know, hundreds, thousands of these type of systems. Now, whether or not they support our life is where the real challenge will be. And we'll be able to see that a little bit better. And in terms of telescope, so James Webb, like Hubble, we will see because there is a visible region as well. But often what we do too is that we attribute with the heat signature or gas. We're able to tell what type of gas, and then they can also create color pictures as well. So if we're not only seeing them invisible, there's a way to replicate it by knowing certain aspects by the measurements we receive. It says, how soon do you think we will actually have settlement on the moon? So NASA is actually projected to send, hopefully they're saying a woman, in 2024 to the moon. Our president has really pushed for that. We shall see. I'm not sure how soon the settlement will come behind. There's been a discussion as to really not necessarily using the moon's surface, but also using something similar to the International Space Station as a platform to excel and to get you further out. So you don't have to use an counteract the Earth's gravitational fields because you've already kind of gotten much higher up. So.
Cool.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So I'm going to make one announcement before we take, final questions. So as you guys know, we had a drawing for an autographed mug by Dr. Ericsson. and the winner of this drawing is Catherine D. So Catherine, if you're here, we will be sending you an email about how you will be able to redeem this offer and get this amazing mug. It'll be great. So check your email soon for that. Let's see. I guess for one final question, if something comes up in the chat, I'll ask that. But also, I guess in general, for lots of young scientists, what advice do you have for students who might not know exactly what field they want to go into, even though they are interested in STEM? And how do you suggest that they find mentors to help them?
Depending on the time that I was in, what kind of where I was at in my life, when I was younger, I kind of looked around, you know, coaches were really great. So your mentor doesn't always have to be in a STEM-based environment. As I began to mature, I also asked teachers. There were some of my teachers were just great mentors. And then eventually doing things like the summer programs. And I think the cool thing about doing summer programs or internships is that you may find out that you really don't like something. And so it's an opportunity to experience something in a shorter period of time, but kind of really see if this is what you really like and what floats your boat. Whether you have the right skills is also important too. You may find out about other opportunities. So I think that summer programs are really important. One person asked about NASA programs, but I really would say that there are many other government agencies, just like the program that we're here on. There are opportunities at universities as well. And then there are professional chapters of, when I say professional organizations, like the National Society of Black Engineers, the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics, there's ASME, which is the American Society of Mechanical Engineers, there's Chemical Engineers, there's like SWE, Society of Women Engineers. There, and for Hispanics, there's the Hispanic Serving Institute, it's called Hispanic Society Professional Engineers. Society Hispanic Engineers, but either way, there are these places, and many of them have student chapters or offer mentors and people that would be willing to help guide you in your pursuit of a career in STEM. So you just have to kind of get out there a little bit and search out, you know, online. There's so many different opportunities. I know that, you know, many of the, like I mentioned, the one at MIT, but Harvard, I know that University of Maryland in my region, somebody was saying they were from Texas. So UTEC has, you know, programs. There are some in El Paso as well as Houston. So, you know, look at the surrounding universities. They look at it, particularly for high school students, as an opportunity to recruit. So many times these programs are free. And they offer you a chance to maybe meet faculty members that you could maybe ask to be your mentor.
Thank you so much for that information. I think that's the end of the questions that we've got. Just wanted to make a quick plug, as you mentioned, about internship opportunities. AEOP does offer a lot of internship opportunities, either on Army bases or, as Dr. Ericsson mentioned, in universities. So you could just be going to a local university lab that happens to be affiliated with AEOP, test the grounds in different areas you're interested in. That was super helpful for me. I was dead set on being a mechanical engineer, but I realized that I liked biomedical engineering instead from an internship. So would highly recommend that. So with that, I just wanted to say a huge thank you, Dr. Ericsson, for coming on tonight for this call and for telling us about your experience. I think we all were really able to grow a lot from this, take out some information that's applicable to us that we can, you know, start working on, whether that be not being afraid to retake a hard class or reaching out to a mentor. So just thank you so much.
You're welcome. And I was thinking about some things that are important in my life. I want to tell students, be well-rounded. Don't just focus on what we say in STEM. It's really important to have the ability to read and write. Even if you're not interested in coding, you should learn some coding. My daughter wants to be a medical doctor, but I said, you know what? You're going to have somebody who's going to want to help you with your data analytics to understand these new diseases or something else. If you don't understand what it takes to do the computer program, then how are you going to hire them to do that work for you? Or maybe you want to do it yourself. If you do a PhD, you're going to do that research. And I did not initially like computers. Like, I learned that it was a tool and I needed to be able to utilize them. So it's very important to be well-rounded in that respect. But the reading is fundamental. And Then the other thing about being well-rounded is that I liked arts. I like to draw and paint, and I like to do even modeling. So I did modeling in clay. I also was very avid, you know, team sports. And I learned a lot about being a leader and working with other people by playing sports. But then I also learned things about myself, like in, you know, in running and cycling, you know, where you really are dependent upon yourself. So I say healthy body, healthy mind. It's really important to take care of all of this, because when you don't feel good, it's very hard to be creative and innovative and to solve our life, our world's problems. So remember that not just to focus on the STEM, but also to pick up the other skills. It's very important to learn how to communicate and to treat people with respect. It goes a long way with me leading and managing teams when I am very respectful and caring. Remembering that people have children, I would often start off conversations before our meeting. And that's actually, I've instituted that at my job, that I felt it was really important because we're all in this virtual world now, that when we start our session for a meeting, we take 3 to 5 minutes where we just ask each other, how are you doing? How's your family? What you do cool? How was your weekend? Really just allowing the personal side of a human to connect with another human being really goes a long way. And people appreciate when you remember that they have a child or a child who's also taking the time away from them at 12 o'clock. We need to finish this meeting because they need to fix dinner or lunch, you know, or whatever. And so really having good people skills is very important as well.
Yeah, your messages are definitely so important, especially for right now, about not forgetting to take care of our like physical and mental health, because it can be so hard, you know, since everything's virtual. You can neglect it and spend the whole day like watching videos for school and never take a foot outside or exercise, you know?
Yeah.
So definitely super, super impactful points.
Melissa, well, thank you. You did an awesome job.
Thank you so much.
And thanks to Dr. Stone and Nicole for inviting me here today. I had a good time chatting with you. It was a great interview again. So I really enjoy your ability to communicate, and you're a great moderator. So kudos to you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ericsson. Sure. Well, that is it for tonight, folks. Thank you all for coming to this episode of Person to Person, and I hope to see you guys again soon. Bye.
Miss an exciting episode of Person to Person? Can't make our live broadcasts? Why not subscribe to the AEOP membership YouTube channel and never miss an episode again? For more information on the Army Educational Outreach Program opportunities in your area, simply visit www.usaeop.com. Thank you for tuning in to AEOP's Person to Person. Join us again in 2 weeks.